holding this track on engineering education addressing professional challenges. We've been holding this track for 5 years now, and this is still a very common current topic because it's still very important since our society is keep on changing and very rapidly. So new jobs, new opportunities arise, so we have to be prepared to give some answers to those new challenges in the professional market. So this is a topic that we just keep on discussing and discussing.
So, this, good afternoon everyone. This year we have very interesting contributions. Mainly, mainly on three subjects that address the concerns of the teachers in our higher education schools. So the three subjects we will be addressing here today is educational experiences, that addresses more the didactical implementations and teachers' reflections upon those implementations. Then students' learning, of course, competence development, etc. And professional challenges, which will address the professional challenges that teachers are bringing into the class. So, I hope you enjoy our communications. Let's start, okay? Oh, I'm sorry. I have two announcements first. Can you change the... you already did it. Okay, so we will be inviting you to submit your extended version of the paper in a journal. It's a good journal, it's in Scopus, so please be aware of my notice in the following days. This will be, it's a call that will be open until August, until the end of August, so you have plenty of time to address this issue. And the papers that are invited by us will have the charges revoked. Okay, so it's a good opportunity. And the second announcement is come to Porto in April. We have a conference, EDUCOM. It's the major conference in this thematic in engineering education. So we'll be welcome. Okay?
No need to say that we are from Polytechnic, of
course. Yes, yes, I forgot that.
So,
okay, let's start.
Yeah, our first presentation is Pablo Rodriguez Gonzalez, and he's going to present Understanding Uncertainties in Thermographic Imaging.
We will be
10-12 minutes talk. We'll give a 3 minutes notice. So if you see the 3 minutes notice, please.
The 3 minutes when?
At the end.
Okay, okay, okay. For the 10 minutes or for the 12 minutes?
For the 10 minutes.
Okay.
They are very bad.
Okay, good afternoon. Thank you for assisting. I'll present the following work. Related to the students' learning, in this case it's work related, how to deal with thermographic imaging. This is work is framed for the student of engineering, industrial engineering, and how to improve the learning of the students how to use this image. We are using more and more in the professional scope. So, thermographic image is a very helpful resource for teaching. In order to the student to see the distribution of superficial temperature and of course to carry out real-time measurements, and it's employed in a lot of kind of experiments as I comment in the slide. So it's a very useful resources, but there are some questions that are due to the constraint of time that are not acquired by the students, some competencies related to the error sources that will affect the final conclusion that the student will maybe commit when they are career in their professional life and career. As I comment, is a key technology that is employed in a lot of fields, and especially for the industrial engineers, with my colleague, and of attend, is the other co-author. And there are limited practical training about this kind of image, sometimes due to the cost of the hardware. So we propose the use of the virtual laboratories, in that case, the super scope of virtual materials, in order to the student acquire the competencies related to the interpretation and knowledge about the different neural sources, but not necessarily in the classroom. They can learn about these competencies online or for asynchronous programs, and also this kind of product can be used as support to classical face-to-face programs. It's prone to use free or open source software for the students in order to carry out different works, and of course it's very important that this approach will allow also to the professor to evaluate the acquisition of the competence to the student, not only to acquisition but evaluate the degree of competence. First of all, I only would like to comment very briefly that thermal image sometimes, nowadays, is usually wrong, especially also in the professional career, with the use of color palette, which is not correct due to the not standard color palette, the non-standard jams, exponential change, etc. The other question is that this kind of image acquires not only the emitted energy by the body, which is the key point at interest part, but also, for example, the reflected thermal energy for another surrounding object. So the question is that the reflected energy when it's emitted is reflected by the atmosphere, so the student has to learn also how affect the condition of the data acquisition to the computation of the temperature, and how will affect to the conclusion, I have to replace this element, this is about the energy balance of the building, etc. So, in order to answer these kind of questions, and also to promote the critical thinking for the student. This first approach, we propose the evaluation of the five key parameters that affect the acquisition and the computational thermal values, the temperature related to the atmosphere, the characteristic of the object, the raw determination of this, and also the presence of different thermal sources, which is reflected at the temperature. In order to prepare this activity, this methodological activity, we try to fulfill the three criteria according to the literature, the reality, the economy, and the quality. The reality is this virtual material, how is the near to the reality, to the use of hardware, real hardware. The sensibility of these thermograms in order to evaluate, for example, the thermal balance of the object. The economic one, which is how to reduce these materials in another subject, for example, of the same degree or the same faculty, which in order to the professor to emphasize for the same image, thermal image, different parameters of different competencies. And finally, the quality criteria related to the possibility to evaluate the competency for the student. And also in the economic, which is the key point, also the use of availability of free and open source approaches. This is the full pipeline of the activity design, but the professor can go not for the steps. But we propose that thermal image can be compared to the raw temperature values using a Octavia or scientific free open free software, and Exit2 another free software, so the professor can with a set with the same set of thermograms and modify the, for example, the acquisition parameters in order to the student to learn how a modification of the parameters will affect and how affect spatially to the computed temperature. The result is not only a typical bidimensional thermographic image, but can be converted using another free software to a 3D model where the only question is that the three dimension is not the relief, as I commented in the examples, but it's the temperature, which allow to the student to visualize the temperature modification, so improve the acquisition of these competencies. This is only very informative because the equation we employ, and of course we cannot use directly the digital values of the thermal image, and the key question is that the professor can adapt the computation in order to what kind of interpretation he or she wants for the subjects. The result of this activity has three kinds: visual, numerical, and the critical thinking or the reflection for the students. The visual, very detailed, this is the thermographic image, this is a conversion using this free open software. It's very similar, pretty similar, nothing new at this question, but this has the third coordinate in this case is the temperature, which can be visualized as 3D, as I comment here, with free software proper for geomatics. Okay, so the students can rotate, modify, and this kind of modification is not the relief of the facade, it's the heat points and the temperature surface. So allow another case for interpretation beyond the classical one. So the student can play with the scale, etc., to identify very easily this difference. Of course, this employs a visual geomatic software, can be used another kind of shaders, visualize viewers, etc., that allow another different visualization, maybe it's interesting for the professor of the specific subject. And the key question or the key point is that it's possible to recompute the same image with different set of parameters in order for the student to compare how affected temperature distribution, which is not uniform. For example, this is the incorrect one, the professor modified a set, so you can see the distribution is not a regular one. So it's possible to understand the modification of these parameters affect to these, for example, elements. It's possible to carry out a very easy subtraction of both images and carry out a computation of the temperature discrepancies. And for example, this the result with the difference with the correct and incorrect parameters. And this can be linked, for example, to the computation of another set of parameters about the statistical significance of the results and linked to another transversal competencies, maybe statistical ones, according to the professor of the subject and the needs of the degree. As I comment here, okay? In order to another statistical concepts. And finally, the third question is that raise the awareness of the students about how affect these parameters to the decision. I mean, these cameras are not a click and shot. They have to know how affect and will affect the temperature and the conclusions. So raise a set of reflection with a supervised by the professor, and this is an example that can be promoted. So in order to conclude, this approach is based mainly in free open software, based on virtual materials can be reused in another subjects, in another subject program, etc. Trying to fulfill the economic reality and quality criteria, the only cost is the hardware, but the set of images can be reused. And the future step about this work, we are in order to expand the error model, because we only consider 5 parameters, and assess how this kind of approach will improve also the academic performance of the student. So thank you very much for your attention. If you have any questions, I'm very happy to answer.
Okay, any question? We have time for 1 or 2 questions. No? Well, I have a question. How do you plan, or did you do it, the assessment of the students' development of consciousness?
Yes, we think it promote as an optative practical lesson in a subject. We have the idea to test in a subject, in an optative subject or a fourth year of the geomatic degree in another university. We have a subject related to thermography, metal detection, and georadar. So, but this year we have no students enrolled, so we have to wait for another year. Mm-hmm. But we can use it in order to test in an optional, because for the student, in order to acquire the competencies according to the plan, and according to the students who carry out the activity, the test, evaluate the how improve the scores, the students who voluntarily enroll to this practical lesson, improve according to the students who didn't enroll.
But in the exam?
Yes, and the exams and all the practical lessons, etc., according to the professor. I will only invite one in order to try this.
You could also use those questions, no?
Yes, that
the students' questions will provide some information. About
yes, the students, for example, the reports.
Yeah.
The reports, what kind of critical thinking will be raised by the students in the reports, which is very interesting. It involves a lot of time, I mean, for the professor, but we have to know at what point this improves really the performance in this kind of subject. Because maybe in that subject, yes, and another subject is not so relevant. Okay, we propose this as a complement, not so far as substitute, because any professor has to evaluate at what point these virtual materials will really improve according to the needs he or she thinks. Okay, at this point, we are very conservative. I mean, not everything has to be changed directly to a virtual approach. We have to test and see if really it's necessary or if improve really. Because maybe with a professor we think, okay, I think it's good to do this for the student, and at the end, for the student's extra time, and it's not a real improvement. Yes. But at the end,
you
we have...
You can join the quality assessment with the quantitative.
Yes, no, no, of course, we need also the feedback from the student. It will be very important in order to... If it really motivates them, improve their motivation, if they believe they will help to the autonomous work. For our students, this kind of problem, because in the classical face-to-face problem, the students then know, from our experience, the autonomous work is very low, but maybe this can improve because they have the elements at home. They can delve on in the competences from the subject, etc. But this is a first approach that we propose, so we need, of course, more study and
yes.
results to
yes.
evaluate.
Yes. Any further questions? No?
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
So our second presentation is still with Pablo. So it's called Short Simulation Activity to Improve the Competences in Fluid Mechanical Engineering Classroom Using SolidWorks. Float Simulation. Okay.
Yes. Yes, thank you, Celina. This work is related to the co-author from the Béjar campus of the University of Salamanca, where he's teaching industrial engineer. So this is related to the fluid dynamics and the acquisition of some competencies very relevant for the professional and the students. Okay. I am surveyor, by the way, so the key questions or very technical questions from the fluid dynamics I am not very good to answer, but I try. The first question is that this work is framed into the fluid dynamic area, which is the study of the fluids and the motion in relation to the solid body, or vice versa. How, for example, the variation of the condition of the body of the solid will affect the movement of the motion of the fluid, and the conclusion that we derived from there is it's very important, has a lot of application also when the new product is generated, for example, from the aerodynamics, etc. This kind of studies are required for the future professional. This fluid dynamic study can be carried out in three kinds of approaches: theoretical, experimental, and computational. In the degree, as I will comment later, is applied the three approaches. So the students have this theoretical, the experimental with physical gadgets, and also they have a computational approach in order to replicate in the computer this experimental approach without the need to be in the laboratory. So this is a application of the computer numerical programs to simulate the fluid dynamics. This is called the CFD, computational fluid dynamics, which allows to the prediction of different variables and also ones related to the thermodynamics, for example, temperature variation, etc. So this is the frame and the context of the present work. This is a teaching resource, is used in undergraduate courses, but the question is that this kind of approach, the CFD, it's very, I mean, complicated for the student in the first years of the bachelor's program. Sometimes this simulation is teaching in master course or adaptive subject in the last year of the degrees, classical degrees. But we believe that it's important, very important for the student in the second year to learn a bit about this software, about how to carry out this simulation, but without being a proper simulation course. I mean, we have a subject, we have some contents, our teaching it, but in order to help the students to know how to use these tools, acquire these competencies. Because this training involves a very long time, so we cannot waste time, I mean waste in the second year, teaching this kind of simulation. But due to the wider scope, we propose one learning activity, in this case the simulation of energy losses in an abstracted nozzle. This kind of example is useful for the student in their professional career because they understand how the presence of, for example, of pathologies, deformation, obstruction inside, for example, a tube, a pin, will affect the energy required, the pressure, so they need to dimension it or modify the size of the installation. Okay, so it's a very important competence. But the question is that sometimes with the classical equation, it's not possible to replicate how this kind of obstruction will affect this installation. So we propose this learning activity. They will know how, for example, the presence of some kinds of deformation, etc., obstruction, will affect the motion of the fluid and another parameters, for example, temperature, pressure, turbulence, etc. And they will use these computer based strategies and compare with the analytical ones in order to provide a very brief assessment about the error. It's not a key point, okay? The comparison between the CFD and the analytical, but it will have a hint about the error, discrepancies, etc. As I comment, this approach is used in the second year obligatory subject, which is called fluid mechanics, and due to the structure in Beja, the 3 degrees of industrial engineer are merged in the same subject. Okay? The two first years are common. And these are the competencies that can be acquired by the student in a different degree, of course, using the kind of activities, especially the specific ones that are the most interesting for us. As material, we use the software, Solid Workflow Simulation. This is a commercial software. Of course, this has a cost, it's a problem in this approach. But when we search the market about the different alternatives, there are free software, but the time for the student to learn how to use this free software is very high in comparison with this commercial software. We have an easy interface for the users. So we prompt to the usability for the student at this degree. And since this software is employed for another subject in the same degree, can be shared, and also can be shared, for example, the geometry in order to simulate the tubes, the nozzle, etc. For the student, we can know how to use, import, etc. But this is a disadvantage, the cost of this. Okay, we are aware, but due to the time and usability, we probably need this. And of course, the other question is the institutional management system within Salamanca is a model. We employ, as the previous presentation, the same approach, the related economic and quality. And in the case of the economic, we plan to reuse this software in another subject in order to reduce the final cost for the institution. And the reality is related to the simulation of quasi-real behavior of the fluids. And the quality is very similar as the previous one. So, we try to provide the practical vision about one specific problem, but the student hasn't to be in the practical, in the laboratory room. They can learn about it remotely, or maybe also in the classroom, but using these computers which will improve also the motivation of the student, which are not the typical equation, etc. We take very care about the processing time, so the geometry of the situation is very simplified. Not so much, so the result will be near to the reality, but the processing times will be reduced. Okay, when the students are processing, for example, in the classroom, the processing time can be used for the professor to resolve questions for the student, but at the end we prefer that the student interact with the software and write questions. Wow. How to compute this parameter, etc. And it's very important that we aim to learn some specific competencies and we not aim to teach about how to use this software. Okay, so understanding some important concepts about fluid mechanics. So for the students, we provide two nacelles, one an ideal and another with a kind of obstruction. And the activity is structured as a follows. It begins with a short theoretical introduction, maybe 10 minutes. They will download the files, and the professor with another example, which is different than the comment before, okay? So with another example, we will teach the students how to use the software, the parameters, and with the parameters that are computed by the software, how they compute the energy losses, because are not computed directly. So the student has to know what parameters has to be applied. And the big part of the activity are the students with the both cases. So they are computing the both the ideal and the structured, and they say the difference, for example, in the results. For the task, the task of the activity, they assign competencies according to the internal codification, which is the manuscript, and the task for a student, and if they use the SolidWorks, or analytical approach, and compare them. We have three kinds of output, the visual, the numerical, and of course, it's very important to raise the reflection for the students about how this obstruction affects some parameters, the temperature, the turbulence, etc. Numerical ones are in the article, and it's not, if interest, we can write to one of the industrial co-authors. And the visual results are this kind of result where they know the particle simulation, etc. And it's recommended. The software do not provide directly the final result. The student has to know how the result in one is the output, the input, are carried out, for example, the subtraction, etc. And this kind of, for example, the difference, the visual difference about the ideal and the structured one. We have a set of different nacelles. I mean, different nacelles, different kinds of abstractions, and different initial conditions for these sets. So we avoid any kind of repetition when we share with that group of students for different years. Okay, so it's very easy to modify to avoid this kind of repetition. So in order to conclude, we provide this, propose this activity to simulate this fluid dynamic and obtain different results, visuals. So how the student in the second year can provide, can produce the kind of visual results in the second year. The critical thinking will be used very for the next years and the future professional application for them. And as future step, we have to evaluate also the performance. We have one this year, we take some questionnaires, but we want to take another questionnaires to carry out a longitudinal study about the feedback of the students. We will look for another application, free, with very easy to use, or a lot of short time to teach, and provide another kind of simulation in the scope of the study. So thank you very much for your attention. If you have any questions.
Minutes to some questions.
I have just one very short question. Do you know how much time do students take to learn how to use the software with CFTP?
In the activity or in the career?
No. When they, is this the first time they use the software?
The module, the flow simulation module, as far as yes.
The first time they're going to use. How long do they have to learn how to use the software, apart from the objectives of the...
No, for the activity they use maybe less than a half an hour with the professor in order to how to use it. Yes, how to use, but he's not in the all the basic or the alternative, it's more...
Very direct.
Guided for the students, so less than a half an hour with another case, which is not the student will play home. And they, when the students have a lot of time, that more than 3 hours for the activity, the students reply, will raise questions, so the professor will profundize in on their own in other issues. But the time devoted to the learning of the software is not, is the minimum we believe in order to the student to carry out the simulation. Okay?
Do you feel that they have to spend the time outside classes before doing the actual classwork to be familiar with the software?
No, the professor, because Manuel, which is the first author, is carry out the teaching and yeah. The students, they in this classroom.
They are able to do it.
Yes. So, 10 minutes for the explanation, about 3 hours for the student, and the rest is with him, with the student, how to use this software.
With these complex softwares, the first lecture,
is the
problem is the learning.
It's the first time with the module, but as far as I know, it's not the first time with the software. It's like a
suite.
I didn't understand.
Yeah. So they already know the software, they used it in
the module, exactly, the flow simulation module.
Yeah.
So the explanation is related to this. They use it in another subject, for example, how to carry out a model, a 3D model, meshing, etc. So the student now how to import the mesh, etc.
I just have a small issue that it's related to that. How open was the activity? How open to the students? There was not an unique response, right? Some students might develop different ways of achieving the results.
As far as I know, I'm not expert in fluid dynamics. The computation of the results are very straightforward. So at the end they have to compute an energy losses, has to be one value, but the students have to compare.
Everyone has the same case?
No. As I commented, every student has a different set, so the answer is very easy to modify the geometry. Okay. We have a set for a few years.
But the instructions are the same for everyone?
Okay. Yes, the instructions are the same, the geometry is not, so the results are not the same for any student. But any student has to obtain the same one theoretical result, but the student has to carry out also the comparison with the analytical equation. And at this point, it's very important because the student will obtain different conclusions. So it's very important in order to see if the student, okay, I have the value, but the student has a proper reflection about this result according to this computer and the theoretical laws. And this question, there will be different.
Everyone has a problem to solve.
Yes, personalized program. It's very easy to modify the geometry and the initial condition. So, we have no problem.
You have mentioned that there is an open source alternative to this one. Just out of curiosity, what's the name of the alternative?
Manuel told me the names.
And you
forget it.
Open France.
Open for one. I remember this. No, yes, I remember this. But I can maybe write now and ask him because he's the professor of the subject. I collaborate in the visualization, this kind of thing, the criteria, etc. But I'm not teaching there.
Okay.
I'm not in the same year. But I will ask him.
Okay.
Okay.
Any other questions? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Lab activities to enhance learning teaching processes in structural engineering courses.
Okay, good afternoon. I am going to explain this work. We have designed several 3D printing models to do some lab activities in some structural engineering subjects in our University of Olavia, Spain. The outline of the presentation is introduction, the use of 3D printing in education, and refer to use preposition modeling 3D printing, not to other additive manufacturing technologies. The context of the teaching experience, our lab activities designed for the and the conclusions. Okay, 3D printing can be used in higher education with 3 points of view, in my opinion. The first one is teaching of 3D printing as a manufacturing technology. 3D printing is polymer manufacturing technology, different than conventional technology, and I think that has to be teach in the universities in manufacturing engineering degrees such as subject or a set of subjects. Also, in some universities offers graduate or master's course about 3D printing, and also there are online courses in like MOOCs in open platforms with MOOCs like Coursera, PDX or Media Lives. Okay. Other use of 3D printing in higher education is to manufacture or to do some specimen to test. Okay, like in place of use conventional materials like steel or concrete or aluminium, we can use 3D printing materials. Here, for example, to do a pencil test. And other use, the third use of 3D printing is for visualization purpose. For example, to visualize some molecules in chemistry or pharmacy. For example, in the left, you can see a photo of a caffeine molecule. And also, 3D printing can be used in medicine, in surgery, for visualize how it's going to be done surgery or a treatment. For example, in orthopedic surgery and traumatology, the patient can be seen how it's going to be done his surgery or her surgery. Okay. I explain now the context of our teaching experience with 3D printing. The lab activities have been prepared for two subjects of the structural engineering field. These subjects are strength materials and theory of structures. Strength materials is a second course or second year course, the first part, with 6 credits. We have 100 students enrolled. This is a compulsory subject in the 3 degrees: mechanical engineering, electrical engineering, and electronic engineering. The degrees are offered by university. And also, some lab activities are for the theory of structure. This subject is only compulsory for mechanical engineering curricula. Okay, I have to stress that our students have a previous knowledge of 3D modeling. They have acquired some knowledge with in AutoCAD, 3D, and SolidWorks. Okay, I present my lab activities. Lab activity number one is pencil testing. The objective of this activity is to obtain the material properties of some materials used in 3D printing, like PDA, ABS, PETG, etc. The objective of the step of the lab activity is to design and print the specimens and to test them. Step two is to test the specimen in a pencil test machine in the lab. Okay, the next step is to record the results and to do processing that data and obtain the cues, the behavior proof of materials. Okay, the lab activity number two consists in the analysis of a class. Okay, so, objective is to design and create a trust structure and to measure the displacement of a node. Also, a complementary activity is to design a structure with the objective of obtaining the best efficient ratio of trust. The efficient ratio is the ratio between applied load and set weight. The winner, this can be a competition among students, and the winner is the structure with the last rate. Okay, the lab activity number three is the more important lab activity of the five. And this activity consists of the analysis of trade events. The students, the objectives of this activity are understand the physical meaning of stiffness, moment resisting frames, and test single by trade events with different conditions, with different geometrical materials, geometrical fluidation, different materials, different lengths, etc. The different geometric thickness materials and loads, the variation of the frame frames are this one. The column length can be once or twice in the beam length. The cross-section thickness of beam can be once or...
The implementation of the learning module was carried out in the 2019 academic calendar in the science programming course with 7 second students of the Bachelor of Mathematics at the University of Guadalajara, who were also studying the linear algebra course for the first time. The use of matrix addition works as a pilot test into our session. In general, a student faced 4 stages in the development of activity. In first stage, the answer question about beliefs regarding the topic matrix addition and the introductory reading of the material. In the second, they interpret the trivial and numerical representation. In the third stage, they perform procedures by drawing workshop and topic present. Finally, in the fourth stage of programming, the calculation based behind reasoning and discussion made the student converted in the development of a software that 2 matrices that represent 2 different images. Okay, next, evaluation. To carry out evaluation process of the learning module, as I said, it was with a focus group, which is a script with the 7 students who practiced in the implementation. In the discussion, the student mentioned that they prudent to make phone sign letters because some code not really well, also that their session with a lot of ready, that it is necessary to visit video that summarize was read in order to make the learning object more striking for them. On the other hand, some difficult present in the implementation of the learning object were with the computer of the laboratory, since they complied the code written in the C++ by the student, some complement the same as library were needed, which were not installed in all computers. Okay, in conclusion, throughout the major in the pilot test and the comment on the student about the learning experience, I was determined that the result is something for them to it is technical design and clearly in the content, with general motivation in the learning processes. Therefore, I can be conclude the learning object has a pretty educational design. I was possible to observe that the learning object has educational potential as the direct tool, since the effect in this application on the learning is positive. That is to say, the student managed to represent them and relate the mathematical object in register of figural and numerical semiotic representation. Likewise, It up to evident that the student internalize the concept through the cognitive process of visualization. And finally, for the continuation of research work, their operational use they must be employed, but in the learning object, I was in the science programming laboratory. Likewise, the different strategies used for the collection must be refined. Excuse me. Thank you very much.
Why did you use C++ for programming language instead of Java or any other programming language easier than C++?
The material, one of those for the programming of science, using the language, C++ language, no more.
And it's the language that they use since the first course. Since the first grade, they are studying C++
from the beginning.
I don't
understand. They use C++ from the beginning of the course, up to the
three.
No, it's Spanish. Sí, en español. Han usado C++ desde el principio.
Ah, en el curso. Sí, desde el inicio. Sí, cuando se aplicó esta implementación ya ellos sabían programar, bueno, los conocimientos básicos de dicho lenguaje de programación.
Okay, I have just a curiosity, okay? You use a focus group to assess this implementation, right?
Aha.
Okay. So, there were 7 students in the focus group. How was that chosen, those 7, or they were invited? Those 7 students?
Sí, 7 students.
¿Fueron invitados o...?
Sí, ellos fueron invitados al curso, a participar ahí en la implementación, en la prueba piloto que se hizo. Mm-hmm.
How did it occur? There were questions raised by the students, or some conversation?
Se hicieron 10 preguntas.
Yes?
Sí, 10 preguntas. Fue a manera así de conversación, como una mesa redonda, un grupo, y fueron compartiendo, bueno, la experiencia que tuvieron respecto a la implementación de los datos.
Thank you.
Okay,
thank you very much.
Of a degree of 3 years of systems engineering. The course has 5 SETSs and it has 6 hours class per week during 11 weeks. These 6 hours class are all for one teacher and it is responsible for the theoretical classes, the calculus, and also the laboratory classes. The syllabus of the course has classical mechanic topics, and in the academic year 2016-17, there was a topic of electricity and circuits. So the teacher, in this topic, included electric circuits analysis, but everything in direct current. So the teacher decided to introduce a remote lab, busy remote lab. That is a remote lab that is developed for remote experimentation on electricity and electronics, and basically it emulates a breadboard with the typical components and devices for circuit analysis. Implemented it in a specific way. in his classes, he decided to use the remote lab before the hands-on lab, the typical traditional lab. Because the difference between these labs is that they have, of course, it's all real experimental results, but in the first one, the students are physical part of the lab, and they use the internet or with a specific interface to manipulate the instruments. What was teacher's goal? He intended to develop experimental skills. He decided to use it before the hands-on lab, so the students could practice at their own pace and trying how many times they wanted, whenever they wanted, because it's a remote lab, it's available 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, from any place. And so they would practice, and when they arrived to the hands-on class, which would be after, they would be more at ease and being able to make the most of it and being more on top. models. So these are EDE implemented in 2016-17 and then again in the subsequent academic years. In this table, there are described the characteristics of the implementation, the number of students, the number of PL classes because they are distributed to many students. The teacher used Vizir, remote lab, hands-on lab and campus classes in all implementations with the same goal, develop experimental skills. Introduced Vizir in the 10th week, so the week before the last one, because it's a course with just 11 weeks, in the first implementation, but in the subsequent ones, he decided to implement, to introduce it the week before, so they had more time to use Vizir. How did he introduce Vizir? He introduced it in the class with a brief explanation, and then he asked students to do the same things that he was doing in the Vizir system, so they could practice and know how to use it. He proposed a task. In the first implementation, it was a series and parallel circuit, and then, again, in the hands-on experiment, in the week after, they would do exactly the same task, more or less the same task. In the subsequent editions, he also decided to propose the students to make a combination circuit. He decided that the students should deliver the task the week after the introduction activity, but just before the hands-on experiment in the first implementation. In the subsequent ones, he gave more time to students to deliver the task so they could use Vizir more and learn more. The task weight in final grade was from 5% to 10% in the subsequent editions, and he also had the opportunity to deliver a student satisfaction questionnaire at the end of implementation, which included two questions where students should say, if they wanted of course, what were the advantages and disadvantages about using Vizir and their experience with the tool. So, what the teacher wanted to see was if how this reflection shaped his design and the subsequent qualifications. It was an action research methodology, so he planned the didactic implementation, he then did it, he observed, and according to his observations and to his perception, he reflected and then amended the original plan, making some changes. Which were his focus of decision? It was teacher's practice about his implementation. It was his research, because he's involved in engineering education research and remote experimentation since 2014. And also from literature, and literature was really fundamental for the planning phase. So, what did he see from literature? He, because of what he saw from the other researchers, decided to plan to get familiarized with Vizir. The teacher spent some time using Vizir, not only to know the tool and then quickly overcome students' difficulties, but also to make sure that students could understand the importance of the tool. He prepared an introductory activity with Vizir, with students, at class. And he prepared some support material that he put in the Moodle system, so students could see the description of Vizir, how they could use it after the introductory activity. He defined the Vizir task objectives, which was to develop experimental skills, so using it before the hands-on class. He put some weight to the fact to the grader. He graded the Vizir task with a weight in the final grade, so an assessment, so students felt they should do it, because if they don't see that it counts for the final grade, probably they wouldn't use it. And he ensures student support during the Vizir activity and the Vizir utilization. So he observed the first didactic implementation, and considering special students' involvement, the hands-on class performance, and Vizir students' results, he decided to make some changes in the subsequent edition. What did he realize? That students really enjoyed Vizir. They liked it and they used it. And they felt engaged with the remote lab. Then, on the class, the hands-on class, which was after Vizir, students were really at ease at the lab and they were feeling really autonomous. Usually this type of classes for the ones that are familiar with these topics at the beginning, because it was first contact, students first contact with these topics. Students don't know how to use the multimeter, special to measure currents, and there are lots of blown fuses. That was not the case. They were autonomous, they were doing the things, and they were discussing with each other instead of calling the teacher all the time. And the grades in this activity were also good. So, in the next implementation, what did he say? What did the teacher do? He enlarged the usage period, so introduced PC before in the semester, so students could use it more. He adjusted student support. Why? Because in the first edition, teacher wanted so much that PC liked the tool, because teacher did and he thought it was a good tool, that he was every time that the student had a difficulty, he was there explaining. The next edition, he gave them time to explore and overcome the difficulties by themselves. As he used several resources, he emphasized the difference between the type of resources, simulation and zone remote class, and the type of results. He increased task complexity, and so the final grade, the task went in final grade. He gave more time to students to deliver the task. He split the task into parts to become more efficient, and he made some adjustments in the lab guide to make sure that the students, he made a lab guide that was a little more requiring, making the students to think a little more and do more things. From the research, he took that it was really important teacher experience with VZ. In the courses there are more than one implementation, he could see that the teacher's acceptance and satisfaction with VZ was increased with the teacher's experience. He noticed that there was some mismatch between the task goal and the task proposed, so he was really cautious about it. He noticed that if the students did the task in a group, they had better results and were more engaged with the tool. And he explained better the difference between these different resources. Besides all that, he noticed that sometimes, if you don't have good internet connection, a good computer room, or if PC sometimes it happens, has some instability, things don't go so well. So all that I have been said until now is in this table, okay? And it is listed according to the main source of influence in teacher decision, okay? As you can see, some of the factors were seen from literature, but then in teacher's practice, he realized them again, and in his research too, some not, just in his research or in his practice. And to conclude, what can it be said? Teacher reflection is really important if you want to improve and to give the students a better environment for learning. These three perspectives, literature, teacher's practice, and research, complement each other. And from teacher's practice, what do we see? That if you split the task in several parts or propose several tasks, students would explore more easily. Introduce VZ as soon as possible in the semester, so VZ students could use it more, and students have some difficulties in understanding the difference between resources and type of resources. And finally, just to finish, attention must be given to the VZ support during the VZ task activity, because sometimes VZ fails. Sometimes there are some instability in the server, and students get frustrated. But if teacher is really cautious about it, he solves the problem and things are okay. Okay, that's all. Thank you very much.
Can I ask one question?
Before you want to make questions?
Yeah. As you know, a remote labs have some problems, and one problem is the dependency on internet. If internet fails, the lab will fail. You said that in the first implementation you give the teacher some support to the
student. I was the teacher in this implementation, that's why she said you.
you gave a lot of support to students for them to overcome the problems. If you didn't do that in the first implementation, if you did it like you did in the second implementation, that you let them to explore the tool, would you say that you would get different results from the first case?
Maybe I was not clear in the explanation. I proposed a nativity to introduce physics, okay? And so I said, okay, you can do this, you should do this to drag the wire and to drag the resistor, explaining everything. And students were doing at the same time. And I was going around the class seeing if they were succeeding. And if they weren't, I immediately said, oh, don't you know? It's like this. Okay? And I think it was not good, okay? Because some students were having difficulties. And I was giving them the answer, but didn't give them the time to overcome. The next time, I made the same activity, but I was going around and doing nothing. And said, are you having some problem? So what do you think is wrong? What can you do? And just if he was real desperate, I would help. Okay? So I think the second time, and then I did it the third time, are better. Sometimes some students do that. Drag the virus, do everything really quickly, and they think it's like a game. It's okay. Some of them look at that and what's this? And really have troubles doing that.
Their feedback about the first case and the second case were different in that aspect, or very similar. They enjoy the tool, and they think they learn about it.
Yes.
And avoid the fuses, the bone-up fuses. Yes.
I don't say that because I don't have time to say everything. Of course, you can read the paper if you want. But that's true. But in the first time, there were just 5 bone fuses in the 4 PL classes with more than 20 students, okay, each. In the second, no bone fuses. And the third, 5, okay. Yes. I didn't have to do anything. Yes. And the students were really at this and enthusiastic, and they had print screens of what they did this year, so the circuits assembly, where they should put the multimeter to measure the current, etc. And they were using it to know what to do in the real lab. They didn't use VZIR in the real lab, they could, but they didn't. But they used the print screens.
Just one question.
You are the
lecturer. Last question. Last question.
For me.
We know, and it's obvious that you are very enthusiastic about VZIR.
I don't know.
And do you feel that if a teacher wants to use VZIR, but is not so into the tool, it doesn't feel comfortable in using the tool, but nevertheless he wants the students to use it. Do you think it would be any difference in the students' motivation to use the tool?
Yes. I think that one of the most important aspects is that the teacher must spend time in the tool to understand how it works. In the first time, I really spent some time understanding it. And if you don't really understand it, you don't probably are not able to overcome students' difficulties very quickly. Because if you don't do very quickly, they are frustrated and they don't use it. And I think that's important. And the data collection or the instability of the system that happens sometimes are also factors that can affect implementation. In the third implementation, I'm not looking at them. At the third implementation, there were some server problems, and if I was not so experienced, okay, in being there all the time, probably there would be lots of problems.
Thank you very much. Sorry.
And of course, I have the help of a technician from his app that is there, as he was there.
Any more questions? No. Thank you very much. So, our last presenter is Federico, and he's presenting the teaching of metrology, the genesis and the epilogue of the tree.
Thank you. is Federico Jacob. I'm here today to present you the work entitled The Teaching of Metrology, the Genesis and the Epilogue of a Degree. Whereas the degree is instrumentation and metrology, the bachelor's at Engineering Institute of Porto. This presentation was divided in four parts. In the first part, I will show how metrology is important for our everyday life. In the second part, I will explain the degree. In the third part, I will explain also the solutions obtained and implemented for the problem we found. Finally, we will show small discussions. So, the degree was R, Instrumentation and Metrology Engineering. Instrumentation is a well-known area from electrotechnical engineering, but metrology almost nobody knows because it's a specific area, but every day we use it. The example I bring here today is the moon landing. A few weeks ago, we celebrate the 50th anniversary for the landing, for the first landing. But the metrology are used, of course, in almost all the missions and also after that. The distance between the moon and the earth are also important in this mission, and it will be obtained using measurement device. Okay, we have here a value, but in metrology we know this value is not exact because we have a range. A range, it's an error. So this value is inside this range. Fundamentally, in practice, metrology is the science of measurements and their applications. Here, with this example, we see an application of metrology. In relation of the degree, the bachelor degree in instrumentation and metrology engineering, we have three fundamental aspects: the instrumentation, the metrology, and the quality. All the degrees are founded in these three aspects. The degree exists from 2006. It was founded to respond to the lack of the actor metrology teaching was not existing in Portugal, but also the lack of engineers with this formation. So, after that, we are here in this side, but we don't see, it's too small, the curricular units. They are founded mainly in physics basis. All the degrees are based in all the aspects of physics related with the instrumentation, metrology, and quality. This is the genesis of the course, of course. But not everything are wonderful. Of course, we have almost in the first years, we have almost a totality of the students have a job in the end of the degree. But after a few years, we have a problem because we don't have candidates to the degree. We have identified two reasons for that. The first, they are confusing the name in Portuguese metrology and the science to see the weather are almost the same name. So it was difficult for students to understand it was an engineering degree. The second aspect was a political aspect. 2 years followed without an average of 10 students, 10 candidates to the degree, and the ministry will close the course. In 2016, they are closed all the access to the course. So this year, 2019, the last students will present their final work and finish the degree. At this moment, only one student are enrolled and probably will finish this year. So it was a pillar of the teaching. But we still with the problem. This problem are the companies need engineers with metrology knowledge. So if it's not possible to open a bachelor's degree in this area, we need of course to find the solutions. What solutions we found? In 2018, last year, we create the postgraduates in metrology and quality. It's the first degree of this kind in Portugal. This year, everything is in Portuguese, sorry. Normally it's for Portuguese students. This year, we are working in the non-graduate teaching course. It's technician, it's for technician, professional, it's a technician professional degree. And probably we will begin the next year. And with these solutions, we continue to divulgate the metrology science in other events, like for example symposiums, metrology days is 29 is May the 20th. We try to associate metrology with other area teach in the ISEP. And of course, what you find? It's very difficult without students. It's difficult economically to offer a degree like that if we don't have students. So the ministry closed this degree because of that. It's not sustainable economically. One solution is to diversify the offer. So we make the post-graduation, then we make the professional courses. But in other end, we are in this moment to try to divulgate the metrology, it's a fundamental science, in the lower education system. And we are waiting for the results, of course, because we think it's important for the students to know the importance. But we also try to do the same with students of other degrees at ISEP. Okay? I think it's everything. Thank you to everyone. For
I have a question. You said that you are divulgating metrology in the lower level of education skills.
Yes.
How are you doing that?
We are doing that through the municipality workers who work every day with schedules, for example in the supermarkets, and that kind of typical divulgations initiative.
And you are going to school saying that?
In this moment not, but we do that in the past.
Any more questions?
Anyone?
Yes.
Thank you very much for your presentation. Jacob, I'd like to put on this simple curiosity. How many courses do we have similar to this one?
Only.
Sorry?
Only this one.
It's the only one?
Yes.
Okay. Second question. How can we live with some short without this science? For instance, because we have an hospital, okay? I have plenty of instruments, and my life depends on this instrument, and how sure I will live.
So, it's important, for example, you go to a doctor normal, and the doctor will try to see your waist to know how many drugs need to give you, and if the scheduler not give a correct value, probably will give you a lot or not a lot drugs, and you still sick.
Or die.
Don't die too late.
Oh, is that a stretch for me? Because this kind of thing. Mm-hmm. In terms of life, what I mean is in this life, in the wisdom of life at all. And it's very strange for me.
Yeah, it's not only human lives that depend on that.
It's not only
structures, buildings, everything depends on metrology.
No, I didn't say everything, but I think some subjects are more important than that. Life is important than life. I my car fails, I don't care about it.
You don't have
if
to be
I
die, quick to die.
Then my car remains okay. I prefer my life. It was a question of priority. I think in some years ago we have some problems in Austria because something, of course, bad. The patient makes some exams and so on. Some analysis, we know that the patient has some problems. Very disease, very often they inject a lot and so on. And then analysis again, and it's low and more problem, and then they tell us.
It is another.
And the patients died.
It happens sometimes.
It's very strange for me. We have a lot of things, hospitals, industry, and so on. And we don't have schools about metrology. And it's very strange for me.
Okay, more questions? So, if not, we had not a
schedule.
So, we'll finish this session for now. There's another one continuing after the coffee break.
Yes, and 6 o'clock again.
6 o'clock, just to be in time. And I wish to remind you that we have a visit, a social event around 8 o'clock. The meeting point is something called Botines, something like that. So you have the information in your documentation. So have a nice coffee break. All of you enjoy this part and keep with us for the next one. Thank you.